Well, good morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the 21st meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2024, and our first after the Parliament's summer recess. So I welcome everybody to this meeting. Fulton MacGregor is joining us remotely. Can I ask, first of all, if members of the committee are content to take agenda items 4, 5 and 6 in private? We are agreed. Thank you very much. Can I then move on to the major part of our agenda this morning? Before I get to that, though, can I ask members of the committee if they are agreed to take next week's meeting in private? Are we agreed on that? We are agreed. Thank you very much. Can I then move on to agenda item 2, which is a discussion on the Tackling Digital Exclusion report, which was produced just a few weeks ago. And I'm pleased that joining us this morning is the Auditor General, Stephen Boyle, and alongside the Auditor General is Gillian Matthew, who's a senior manager in Audit Scotland, Bernie Milligan, who's an audit manager in Audit Scotland, and we're also pleased to welcome this morning Mike Nielsen, who's a member of the Accounts Commission, because this was a joint report between Audit Scotland and the Accounts Commission. We've, as usual, got quite a number of questions that we'd like to put to you, but before we get to those, Auditor General, could I invite you to make a short opening statement?
Good morning, Convener. Good morning, Committee. Many thanks. Convener, as you mentioned, today's report is a joint report that Audit Scotland has prepared on behalf of myself and the Accounts Commission on tackling digital exclusion. Digital services bring many benefits, and public bodies need to use digital technology to improve their services. It offers opportunities for efficiencies and improved accessibility. And digital transformation is, of course, an essential part of public service reform. However, public bodies must recognise the needs of those who do not have digital skills or access to digital services or an internet connection in their homes. One in every six adults in Scotland lacks essential digital skills, and 9% of Scotland's households do not have an internet connection. Our audit adopted a human rights-based approach and considered the rights of people and how those are affected by digital exclusion. During the course of our audit, we spoke to people who had lived experience to provide insight and inform our audit work. We also focused on recent developments to address digital exclusion across the public sector. We considered initiatives put in place since the pandemic and assessed how the public sector is addressing digital exclusion. It can have a severe impact on people's lives, limiting access to services, affect social, economic and financial well-being. And we also found that people who already face other disadvantage are therefore more likely to also experience digital exclusion. Convener, the public sector's response to digital exclusion, which was a focus in the early years of this decade during the pandemic, when we found that it increased significantly. As the world at that point moved online, the Scottish Government worked with councils and other public bodies, and particularly the third sector in Scotland, to support over 60,000 households to access devices, data and skills. At that time, it delivered at scale and pace to provide what was an emergency response. Since then, however, we found that leadership to address digital exclusion has since weakened and the momentum towards digital inclusion slowed. The National Digital Strategy ambition that no one is left behind, but it lacks both a clear action plan and clear lines of responsibility. We recognise, of course, in the current context of difficult public finances that the Scottish Government and the wider public sector is currently operating in, presents a challenge in deciding public spending priorities. The Government needs to be clear on its policy ambitions for digital exclusion and how it will therefore deliver these within this challenging context. All public bodies have a responsibility for enabling digital inclusion. They must put people at the heart of change and reform, supporting them to use digital tools in a way that benefits them and making sure they can access the services, the vital public services that they need. Convener, in our audit, we found some good examples of public bodies working to enable digital exclusion, and have included some case studies within the report. We also set out some important principles that public bodies should consider as they further adopt digital technologies, that they have clear plans that focus on the needs of people and improve coordination across the public and third sector. Convener, as you've mentioned, I'm joined by Gillian and Bernie, who are the two authors of the report, and also pleased that Mike Nielsen from the Accounts Commission is with us today, representing the joint interest of this report and covering the wide breadth of public services in Scotland. We look forward to answering the committee's questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And can I begin on a more positive note, which is, I think you are regularly before the committee calling for public sector reform. And I think one of the strands of that reform, which many people identify with, is the introduction of digital technology, albeit that this report is about how that is implemented and who is included and who is excluded from it. Could you maybe elaborate a bit more about why you think digital technology is central to that public sector reform agenda? And you mentioned in your opening remarks about some examples in the report. I think Social Security Scotland is mentioned in particular. But could you maybe share with us a bit more about those examples of what you've identified as being good practice?
Yeah, very happy to do so, Convener. And I'll bring colleagues in, actually, just to maybe broaden out some of the examples. The committee, I think, will be familiar with, as we've spoken about, I think, a number of times in different reports, the NHS Near Me as being one of the recent developments in the use of digital platforms that can have a positive impact. And I think particularly in that example about broadening access to services, our report found, Convener, that access to services digitally, whilst also have a bearing in terms of people's digital skills and, you know, whether they have devices or connections within their home, there's also a geographical component to it, that, you know, people in more rural parts of Scotland are less likely to have super fast broadband distances to travel. And, you know, whilst at times it can appear that, you know, there needs to be a uniformity of service, what we found with the NHS Near Me case study, I'll bring Bernie in a moment to say a bit more about that, is that it's an example of innovation. And we know that public services are going to have to innovate, both to keep pace with people's expectations of, you know, so as we all of us use devices, we carry devices, sometimes multiple devices around with us, how we live our lives. Public services are going to have to move with that. So both about accessibility and also an element of economy, Convener, that digital services, adoption of digital technology offers a path to efficiency. The one caveat before passing to Bernie to say more, Convener, is that as we're on the cusp of a potentially quite significant public service reform, is that there is an increased risk that the pace of public service reform and the adoption of yet more digital technology leaves people behind. So the opposite of the government's stated ambition of no one being left behind, that therefore one of the key recommendations in today's report is that service users remain at the heart of transformation, particularly digital transformation, that we equip people either with the skills or devices, or we offer a range of ways that people can access services. I mentioned NHS Near Me, Convener. Bernie might want to say a bit more about that, and we can also say further about Social Security in a moment. Bernie.
Thanks, Auditor General. Yeah, just to say a wee bit more about NHS Near Me. It's a video consulting service, and that's enabled people to attend healthcare and other appointments remotely. And we've included that in a case study within the report. We've seen a massive acceleration in terms of the use of Near Me by clinicians, by patients looking to use that from the pandemic onwards. And I think there was a recognition within the digital health and care team that there were some things that could be done to make sure that there could be wider access to that facility. And we've seen good use of quality impact assessments within the Digital and Health and Care Directorate to really look at what could be done to widen that access. There has been some innovation in terms of putting near me into community hubs and into libraries, and that's been as a result of recognising that not everyone has a safe and appropriate space within their home. Not everyone has a secure connection, and not everyone is skilled and confident enough to use something such as Near Me. But it's certainly working collaboratively with library services, with other communities. We've got the example of Argyll and Bute providing in a village hall a space where people could use Near Me, and that obviously saves people from remote rural and island communities from travelling to mainland hospitals and so forth, and obviously the cost associated with that as well.
Okay. I mean, when I look at the Scottish Government's strategy document on it, it says we will ensure that all public services are designed through the lenses of inclusion, offering signposted alternative ways of accessing services for those who cannot or do not want to use digital routes. I mean, to what extent is that happening, though? I mean, you've mentioned the example of Near Me, but across the whole of the public sector and the provision of public services, how often are you seeing those services designed through the lenses of inclusion?
I mentioned in opening remarks, convener, that we adopted a human rights-based approach to this audit. And again, I think I'll pass to Gillian, actually led a lot of the interaction that we had, where we sought the views of people who were accessing public services across the piece, and might want to say a bit more about local authority aspect to this. And that wasn't their experience, convener, that they had consistent access in a way that addressed services for their purpose. So people telling us through the audit that they struggled to find a consistent, straightforward, accessible way of accessing the range of public services. So whilst the ambition is clear in the strategy, and I think before passing to Gillian to elaborate as she wishes, what we found in, I guess, one of the key findings in today's report is that whilst the strategy from government and COSLA was consistent about tackling digital exclusion, we found that there was a lack of clarity about what specific actions and accountability would deliver upon the strategy. But Gillian can say a bit more about the experience that we found of people and the work of public services.
Yeah, I think as Audit General is saying, that there's, although there's that commitment, we are seeing a lot of variation. So within Scottish Government, you mentioned Social Security Scotland as well, and we're just talking about within the Digital Health and Care Directorate. That's where we're seeing that they're much further forward with this, but it's still quite separate. It's not getting joined up across Scottish Government about the learning and the sort of good practice that they're doing. And then the work that we did actually in the council areas, so Renfrewshire Council was one of the areas that we did the lived experience work, and we spoke to people. And part of taking a human rights-based approach was that we spoke to people first to find out what the issues were. I mean, we had an idea, of what some of the challenges and barriers were, but we want to hear firsthand from them, in their own communities, what were they facing? And then we used that information to feed into our audit and then ask questions of the council, the Scottish Government and others. I was going to say something else there, and it's gone around the lived experience work. Sorry, it might come back to
me. I mean, when I read the report, I'm going to bring Graeme Simpson in for a quick question in a minute. But when I read the report, the striking thing to me is in the introduction you say, paragraph 6, digital exclusion is strongly associated with poverty and people with poverty and people with certain protected characteristics. You then go on to say in paragraph 13 that the reasons for digital exclusion are affordability, whether people have got the skills, whether people have got fear or mistrust of digital systems, poor connectivity, or that people cannot afford to keep up with technological change. And again, you reiterate, I think, in paragraph 16, that the major causes of digital exclusion are poverty, are for people who are on benefits, are because of the age of people. Presumably older people are less likely to be able to access digital technology. People with a disability that have to overcome barriers to access it, and people that are living in social isolation. So there's a very clear sense from that, isn't there, about who predominantly the people are amongst our citizens who are excluded from these public services which are digitally provided.
So that's absolutely right, Convener. You know, frames the report, and perhaps I've mentioned a couple of the statistics around this in our introductory remarks, but perhaps highlight to the committee Exhibit 1, which we draw on some of the Ofcom survey data from 2022 about the extent to which people who do not use the internet, so you mentioned the older people, those from the more socially deprived groups in society, people living alone, already on benefits, those with a disability. And then what we sought to do, kind of broadening out for that, is to kind of, what does it actually mean, triangulate that, about how people are accessing services and some of the compromises that they need to make people that we engaged with during the course of our audit work spoke about how, in those circumstances, they rely on support of others, where it's available to them to do so. And that can involve some quite significant personal compromises for people. So they might need to share, you know, sensitive medical information, sharing their financial details, passwords that they have that are required of sometimes multiple passwords. So significant. And questioning whether these are necessary compromises for people to make to access vital public services. So these are the very clear individual challenges that people who are already facing, you know, difficulties, poverty, I think, and maybe just to finish, Convener, that, you know, we frame our report as digital exclusion, but there are broad overlapping definitions that others refer to as digital poverty.
I think that you make about this making an unequal society potentially more unequal is made in the report. Again, I look at paragraph 18, where you talk about the negative impacts. People who are digitally excluded are less likely to get access to information in general, less likely to get access to the jobs market, less likely to know about their children's education, less likely to maximise their financial position because they can't get access to things that would be cheaper if they were able to use that route. They incur debts. It can heighten social isolation. So there are all these results which compound inequalities rather than address them. And if I go back to the government stated position, they say in A Changing Nation, we tackle poverty by sharing opportunities, wealth and power more equally. It doesn't seem to me that there's an awful lot of evidence of that.
Very much so. That's, as you mentioned, Convener, paragraph 18 sets out quite starkly the impact of being digitally excluded, education opportunities, training, social interaction, basic information that and opportunity that many of us take for granted, and a stated ambition for, you know, as we all move forward with the adoption of more digital technology, is that we don't do the opposite of what's intended and making it a more straightforward place for us to live, operate successfully, but rather we risk excluding people yet more as the pace of change quickens.
Thank you. Graeme Simpson, do you want to come in briefly at this point?
Very briefly, sure. Because there was mention of the Near Me.
Yeah.
I don't know what it is, an app or a service. Should we call it a service? Did you do any research to find out how many people can actually have access to this?
So we mentioned in the case study, Mr. Simpson, and Bernie might want to say a bit more, but just the... So this is a relatively new arrangement. I think that's one of the aspects to highlight. Two things maybe is that NHS Near Me is providing over 30,000 consultations per month within the NHS in Scotland. And in terms of, you know, access arrangements, one of the successes, I think what we sought to do in today's report is that it's it reflects that digital technology is going to change. But their key recommendation in today's report, in my mind, is that as that pace of change develops, it engages with the public. Public bodies have to engage with service users. And NHS Near Me did that. So they involved people in the design of the service. NHS Near Me will suit some people, no doubt, as, you know, allows them to access a GP service, as Bernie's mentioned, you know, more conveniently, more quickly perhaps than they might otherwise be able to if they are required to follow the more traditional route of phoning their GP, arranging an appointment, and how straightforward or otherwise that might be the current climate. So we said Bernie can come in, I'm sure, say a bit more about the kind of detail behind it, but what we tried to do is that balance in the report to say that this is one of the approaches that public bodies will be using, and getting it right with that co-design right at the start. Bernie,
what I'm actually after is whether you know what percentage of GP practices are offering this. Now, you might not know that, because it's quite difficult to find out this information. As you know, they're all individual businesses. It is quite difficult to find out what their working practices are, but I just wonder whether you know that.
No, I don't have any stats on that. Obviously, we've got the stat in the report around 33,000 consultations every month. We know that it was a very low base prior to the pandemic. There are reports that give some of those statistics in terms of the growth in Near Me, but we don't have that stat. Whether that exists, I'm not sure. There is aspirations for Near Me to go beyond the NHS, and I think there's some work at the moment through like Social Security Scotland, care services also using that tool for video consultations. So I'm sure the government could talk more on that as well.
Thank you. I'm keen to move things on, and the Deputy Convener's got a number of questions to put to you. So, Jamie, over to you.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Auditor General and guests this morning. Can I start with an overarching question? It's maybe one I'm less about the specific content, but more the theme of what you want us to take away from this report. Because I get the impression, on one hand, we certainly as a committee often hear in reports such as this, that we're pushing the government to go further, faster with public service reform, that actually too many public services are still clunky, they're still physical, they're still paper-based, they're not digitised, they're not modern in the way that they could and should be. But on the other hand, we seem to be beating the government with a stick for moving too fast and leaving people behind. And I'm not quite sure what it is, the overarching theme is you're saying in this report. Is it that you are going too fast and you need to take people with you, or you need to pick up the pace of digital reform but not leave people behind? Or both, perhaps?
So I think it is both, actually. And I'll give Mike a chance to say a bit about Council's perspective on this in a moment. So, you know, the theme is that, if stepping out the digital report for a moment, of challenging public finances, one I think we've said for a while, and the sustainability of the current arrangements to deliver public services. And therefore, public service reform is an essential component to address the challenges that are facing public services. So nothing, I think, in today's report detracts from that. But what we found during the course of the audit, that to deliver effective public service reform, you're going to have to adopt digital technologies. But to encourage public services as they do that, is that retained recognition, Deputy Convener, that there are many people in Scotland who cannot access public services digitally in the way that they'll need to. So how they have acquired the necessary digital skills, just the means with which to access digital services through devices, through internet tariffs and so forth. And then if none of that works, that there's a safety net for access to public services in some of the more traditional forms, the traditional channels that people will just have to bear. Public services, for the risk of stating the obvious, forgive me, that public services are not businesses. So whereas a business can herd, as some of the terminology that's used, members of the public or their customers onto a digital platform, public services don't have that opportunity. They're going to have to be considered and think about how they successfully bring people into a digital environment or have that safety net of a range of different ways to access it. So we look to address those range of themes in today's report. But again, I think it's appropriate to bring Mike in, actually, just to given the co-author nature of today's.
Thanks very much. And maybe on the, I think one of the really important parts of this report is that by improving the quality of digital services, making them more easily usable, not requiring provision of lots of information, lots of passwords, having a degree of consistency across different services so that if you press a particular button on one service or on the screen, you get the same thing as you do on another service. All of those things should contribute to addressing some aspects of digital exclusion, the ones that relate to skills and confidence in some respects. So I think that in terms of your direct question, it's moving faster in that way to get a greater degree of consistency across government services. And that is, I think, in part one of the reasons why we have a joint report, because the Once for Scotland message is really, I think, quite important in terms of the making it consistently easier for those people who's who face challenges, and indeed for the rest of us. But and in terms of the other end of the spectrum, in terms of addressing the most vulnerable groups, the combination of better services and really effective local understanding of the nature, extent, location of the digital exclusion problem is, I think, pretty central to helping to deal with those who are the most vulnerable and for whom a digital solution is most only part of the answer. And we have seen in the work some good examples of that happening, of really engaging with local communities in order to get a clear picture of the challenges they face, and then trying to take a strategic approach to address the issues, whether they be the connectivity issues, the cost of having a service, skills and confidence issues. So if you look at a place like Renfrewshire, and I think also Perth and Kinross, they are working in that way. But again, coming back to the sort of the fact this is a joint report, having an overall strategy for the Scottish public sector, which explicitly addresses all of the causes of digital exclusion is really important for setting the framework for those local actions.
Isn't that part of the problem, Auditor General? Just using the language you use in the report, and you've repeated it in your opening statement, is relatively harsh in terms of its analysis. Possibly, you say that leadership has weakened, momentum has slowed. There's a lack of an action plan, a lack of lines of responsibility. I mean, these are really common themes that we hear in this committee across a wide range of public services and government management and oversight of it. Does this come as a surprise to you? Is there a feeling that perhaps it's not a case of the government's taking its eye off the ball due to perhaps pressures on public finances, but it was never perhaps on the ball in the first place. I'm trying to get a feel for whether the direction of travel is worsening, or whether that strategy has never been there in the first place.
So a number of strands to that, Deputy Convener. I hope I'll pick them up. So I think there has been momentum, and I think certainly during the pandemic and the work of Connecting Scotland with public bodies across the country, and especially the engagement that they had with Scotland's third sector, led to very significant impact of tackling digital exclusion. Now, we mentioned over 60,000 households in Scotland received devices or support to tackle digital exclusion. Colleagues may want to say a bit more about the Connecting Scotland, because clearly, as you know, that was an emergency response during COVID, amongst many other aspects of how public services responded. That I think it's reasonable to say that model wasn't a sustainable one in terms of cost and wider resources. So, and that was, you know, effectively the valuation of Connecting Scotland said that I think particularly the dominance of the one-to-one support model just, you know, wasn't something that they could continue with. The level of public funding wasn't going to be available to support that. The question about, the overall judgment, or one of the aspects of the judgment in today's report about leadership and momentum, is, I think, in our view, based upon a number of aspects, maybe to draw to the committee's attention, like the timeline of in Exhibit 4, whereby, you know, digital strategies, ambitions to tackle digital exclusion, we trace that back to 2011, with very positive developments. And I think in today's report from Counts Commissioner myself is that we are citing, you know, strong examples of where public service has adapted and has brought service users with them as they've changed the way that public services are delivered. So perhaps at that high point in the emergency of the pandemic, Deputy Convener, we're confident in our judgment that momentum has stalled. That we have the joint national strategy from March 2021. And as you mentioned, I suppose, alluding to some of our other work in recent months, that strategies will be the best chance of being successful when they're underpinned by clear next steps. Clear action plans, good governance, clarity around leadership, and timescales and resources to go with it. That's where we think momentum has stalled, so that there isn't that clarity of who's going to do what next and how it's going to be paid for. And without that, we think there's a risk of, you know, the progress that we've seen in points over the past decade not being carried through upon. And especially now with the ever-challenging fiscal context that Scottish public services are operating in, and as the convener was referencing, as we adopt digital technologies ever more, not everybody's going to be able to move at the same pace. And there is the risk that it goes contrary to the stated ambition that no one's left behind, is that even more people could be left behind.
I mean, looking at that timeline, it's quite stark. If you take a pinpoint in it, you know, when I joined this parliament in 2016, I sat in a committee room not far from here where we discussed the procurement of the R100 programme. Yet in your report, you know, it points towards, 10% of the population still don't even have internet. So, you know, and that's some 8 years on, nearly a decade on, and there's still a large chunk of people who do not have the digital skills or digital access. So, you know, that speaks naturally for itself. Is there any particular reason why the progress on the reaching 100, and presumably reaching 100 means reaching 100% of the population, it was not quite included in this particular report? I appreciate it. There's some overlap with some of the work that Ofcom have been doing around this, but it's surely the infrastructure needs to be there before you can start teaching people the skills to use it.
Yeah, you're right. I think just to reference for absolute clarity, our audit didn't consider the progress of the R100 programme or indeed other broadband connectivity programmes. And my predecessor reported to the predecessor committee on the progress of the R100 programme. It's something I'm keeping under review as part of my own forward work programme and may return to it in future years as progress develops. Just branching off from that slightly, Deputy Convener, I think particularly drawing on the experience of our advisory panel and those with lived experience of digital exclusion, we did speak to people in rural areas of Scotland, and you know, there's a perhaps quite a stark quote in the report of a person from Argyllan Butte who, you know, talked about an ambition to return to the area having studied in the Central Belt and felt like the quality of internet connection was a barrier to them and others from the area, meaning that it would a barrier to working from home, starting businesses. So we haven't looked at R100 in detail in today's report, but so it's something we're keeping on the radar.
No, obviously, the associated effects of rural depopulation and tackling that digital inclusion is one of the key drivers to repopulating rural and island communities, of course. But perhaps, and this is maybe a more macro question, was there any expectation, perhaps, in the draft of this report that some of these issues might have been addressed in the Human Rights Bill that was we expected to see in the programme for government? And is there, do you think, any feeling of disappointment that it hasn't featured in the government's legislative plans? And what effect will that have, do you think, on the ability to ensure that everyone in Scotland is digitally included?
So Gillian might want to say about our progress of tracking the Human Rights Bill, but I think the committee will know that it's neither my nor the Accounts Commission's role to, I guess, comment on the merits or progress of individual policy choices that the government and the parliament choose to make. But in human rights more generally, as we've done in a number of our audits over the past few years, is sought to reflect that in our audit methodology, that audit work is relevant to people, that, you know, we are tracking human rights alongside our audit work and weaving that in where appropriate. But Gillian might want to say a bit more.
Yeah, I think we're obviously aware and we're kind of involved in discussions around the human rights, the development of the Human Rights Bill proposals, aware that's now been delayed slightly, but I think we'd started this work before the Human Rights Bill proposals had been put forward. And as Audit General says, it is something that we're considering our work much more, not just the qualities angle, but, you know, the human rights side of things as well. And I think the discussions we had around people's rights as part of this audit, I think, you know, digital and internet access itself isn't a human right, but it is it's becoming an essential utility to be able to take part in public services and have your rights realised. So it's very, you know, it is really important from that aspect. And it's something that came through really strongly. And I think when we were speaking to people within the two council areas where we did the field work, we weren't necessarily asking them about their rights, but as we talked through, you know, what the issues were facing, and it came clear that some of their rights weren't being met. And that's where we set out in Exhibit 2 on page 13 and 14, actually, because there was quite a lot came through, as you can see, about different aspects of human rights and how they're affected if people are digitally excluded. So, I think it's something that we're certainly aware of and building into our work much more. And we will, you know, sort of think about the Human Rights Bill and how that affects our work, obviously, as that develops. But it's something that's, you know, a kind of priority area for us at the moment anyway.
That's great news. I was really taken aback by the statistic that 1 in 6 Scots lack foundation level digital skills, not advanced digital skills, but basic digital skills. 1 in 6 adults. How does that compare, perhaps, to, you know, other parts of Europe or the United Kingdom? Are we faring well, or is that just a sort of world average at the moment?
It's probably something that Bernie can say a bit more around the stats, but it's quite difficult to get reliable information, actually. So a lot of the stats are based on UK stats, but, you know, a lot of them are going to be, you know, similar or the same for Scotland. But we didn't really look too widely. But I don't know if there's anything else you want to say, Bernie.
The Lloyd survey is seen as the benchmark in terms of digital skills, and it's carried out annually. It looks at foundation digital skills, such as turning on a device, being able to manage passwords, Wi-Fi connection, and so on. They do report on different parts of the United Kingdom. Obviously, the statistics for Scotland are that 15% don't have all eight of the foundation skills that are within the survey. I only have one stat here in terms of UK-wide, it's 16% for the same period. But what's also to note is that stat has remained the same for last year as also, so there seems to be a wee bit of kind of flatlining in terms of that. Obviously, within the report we have drawn in, and I think it just shows you the complexity of digital exclusion. We've had to draw in quite a number of different national data sets in terms of skills, in terms of access to an internet connection in your home, and obviously the Ofcom data as well in terms of who's affected.
Thank you. I'll maybe come back in later with some other questions.
Yeah, OK. Thanks, Jamie. I think Graham Simpson wants to pick up on some of those points and develop others. Graham.
Thanks very much, Convener. Can I just go back quickly to the R100 question? Because I'm a bit puzzled as to why you didn't go into this a little bit deeper, because surely this is key. You know, if people actually don't have access to the internet, then they are automatically digitally excluded. So I just wonder what was the reasoning for your decision not to go into that?
So I think it really, when framing any piece of work, we have to take a view about the key components of policy development, implementation, and what we want to achieve from the audit, and also whether we've done any other work in this area. And on R100, Mr. Simpson, we have done work. We did a, trying to recall exactly off the top of my head, I think it was broadly at the start of my term, I think I inherited our work on R100, so late 2020, if memory serves, I can correct that if that's inaccurate, convener, we produced an update on the R100 programme. As I've written to the committee in recent times, it remains part of my thinking for future audit work. You suggested it's a key factor, Mr. Simpson. I think it's one of the factors that around digital exclusion, that of superfast broadband and the rollout of the R100 programme, but not the sole factor. So particularly looking at other components of what are those drivers, and when we set out whether people have the skills and confidence to use digital technology, that may or may not be influenced whether they have internet in the home, their ability, as public services are designed to support their access to tackle digital exclusion. So just to reassure the committee, it remains on my list of future topics to return to. But we felt, both the Accounts Commission and I, in engagement with Audit Scotland, that it wasn't so fundamental to cause us to pause or delay the development of our work on digital exclusion. And I think really as a precursor to other work that we'll be bringing to the committee in relatively short order about public service reform more generally, public finances and efficiencies, that as those projects move at pace, is that public services remain very mindful about access to public services for all the population, not just those that are digitally enabled.
Can I just sort of turn this around on its head a bit? Because digital exclusion might be a choice for somebody. You don't have to have a mobile phone. You don't have to have a computer. And some people may choose not to have either. And that's just the way they want to go through life. There's a cost to these things, of course. Sometimes it's not cheap to have broadband in your home or to have a mobile phone with full access to the internet. So, you know, are people, do you think there's a risk of people who make the choice not to be digitally connected being excluded from public services? We are talking about public services.
I mean, I'll speculate a little bit of that, actually, but I think it's maybe helpful for the committee to hear from colleagues, for us to convey the views of people who consider themselves to be digitally excluded, and whether that was a choice that they were making or was being made for them. And I think that's the fundamental difference. You know, so if people, as is their right, Mr. Simpson, you know, if you choose not to have a mobile phone or the internet in your home, you know, you at a very basic level should still be able to access vital public services that you need to. It might not be in the way that you would have done 20, 30 years ago, but you know that there's a safety net within society to give you that access. I suspect that's probably not the case for the vast majority of people now, is that, you know, just to successfully access workplace, skills, training, social interactions, access to more cost-effective goods and services. You know, very, very many of us now have access to the internet. So for perhaps going back to, if I may just briefly, the convener's opening question about the statistics suggest that people who are experiencing other forms of barriers are most likely to be digitally excluded. Before passing to Gillian Burney, and might want to come in as well, of course, just the point about one of those barriers about the internet and mobile phones. And our report refers to what is known as social tariffs for members of the public who are economically disadvantaged. Ofcom have set out through the providers of broadband and mobile services the provision of social tariffs. But we found that while eligibility was clear, only a very, very small percentage of people are actually taking up these tariffs. So there's a gap, and as the provision of them, the promotion of these tariffs, something's not quite working in there. So we note that in our report as one of the recommendations for the government and public bodies to engage with providers and Ofcom about what more can be done to support the uptake.
So before you bring them do you think that's because people are not aware of these tariffs?
Gillian can say more about that, actually, but awareness of them, and perhaps also the definition of them as well. You know, what's required of a social tariff is also a factor for people to engage in that service. But perhaps pass to Gillian initially, just to kind of set out about, what were people telling us about whether this was a choice being made by them or others to be digitally excluded?
Yeah, I think it's both, actually. You know, some people do choose not to, they don't have a smartphone. But for other people, they did have the technology, but it's back to skills or having good access, the affordability. As the Auditor General said, around the social tariffs, that it's a small percentage. Only 8% of eligible households had signed up for social tariffs. So there's obviously a lot more there available, but it is down. We set out in paragraphs 84 and 85 around that. There is a lack of awareness around that. But actually, some of the tariffs are still too expensive for some people. So it's back to that, the really strong link there to poverty and digital poverty for people. But I think the fact is that there are so many services online now. So, but what we're saying in the report is that's fine. There's benefits from that. It works for a lot of people. It makes it easier for people. That's a choice for a lot of people to do it that way. But for those that can't or are unable or don't have the skills, then there should be alternative methods. So. It could be really straightforward things like just having a phone number. Some people were saying they couldn't even find a phone number on a council or another service website, to actually speak to someone in person. A lot of offices are closed now. But some of the areas where we're seeing the good practice, they've got community hubs, they've got libraries are supporting people. So some of them are, it's fairly straightforward things, and again it's back to that sort of working together with other services. to help people access and you know, and provide support to, for people when they can't do it themselves.
All right.
There's anything else, Bernie?
Yeah, right, or might be. Not very much to add, but I think looked at from the point of view of a public service provider, it's understandable that you would want to encourage people to use the digital channels because they're you know, orders of magnitude cheaper on a per unit basis. And it's getting that balance right that, as people are encouraged to use the digital channel, but there are alternatives for those who, for whatever reason, are unwilling or unable to use the digital channels. And as already said, the most basic is to be able to find the phone number, given the frustration you can have in trying to do that. I think the other point on choosing not to be online, I think relates to the concern about security aspects and you know, personal information and so on. So I think that's another facet of trying to address digital exclusion is to try and provide greater reassurance that the systems that we have are robust.
I think you're right, Mike, because the moment you go online, you're potentially exposing yourself to risk. So although probably everyone in this room has access to digital, there might be people out there who just think, that's too risky for me. I'm going to move on to something else because we discussed earlier the human rights issue, and I'm drawn to Exhibit 2, where you give a number of examples of where human rights could be affected. So I suppose my general question around this is, do you think that people's human rights are being impacted or indeed being breached by not having access to digital services?
So that was certainly the view of some of the people we spoke to, Mr. Simpson. That, and we always look to do in that exhibit from feedback from the focus groups that we held and drawing on the evidence of third sector was to map human rights to some of the examples of digital exclusion about you know, the accessibility, the pace of change, skills and competence of people, and then their ability to provide public body's ability to provide services on an equitable basis. So these are what we've looked to do is rather than say definitive judgment to say you know these individuals' human rights were breached. I suspect that would be a matter of law with which to kind of form that judgment. Is to say like, these are potential areas that public bodies, as they are delivering services today, and also looking at further changes to public services, public service reform, probably more adoption of digital technologies. As they think about that, what does it mean from the individual's perspective? And perhaps just to highlight in the report, we also looked at some of the design principles for the future of public services and make some of our own principles for the type of areas that public bodies should consider when changing public services so that human rights are borne in mind and we have that equitable access and provision of public service.
So if human rights are being breached, neither of us are lawyers, but is there a risk then that the Scottish Government and indeed other public authorities could face legal action?
So I think, as I've said, this is a risk. This is a potential area that of human rights. We did not set in a report to adjudicate upon that, but rather to highlight that the pace of change and the... So some of the evidence before us as of the way public services are changing and the access to services that members of the public either have or don't have is that this is an increasing risk around human rights.
Okay. I've got one more question. I'm going to ask about the Digital Inclusion Alliance. Perhaps you could explain what on earth that is. And when you're answering that, could you tell us why, you know, why its launch didn't go ahead? And then if you could go on to discuss the Digital Citizen Division, also tell us what that is. and why there's been slow progress on that since it was formed.
Yeah, I'm going to bring some colleagues in, Mr. Simpson, just to kind of set out, I suppose, some of the structural and governance arrangements around tackling digital inclusion. We bring Bernie in first, and Gillian might want to develop. There are a number of players in this environment, you know, and indeed there are shared ambitions between the Scottish Government, COSLA, and long-established engagement with the third sector, SCVO, about the reach that voluntary organisations in Scotland have in provision of service. Strategies are fine, but needing to have clear governance and action plans to support it. So perhaps turn to Bernie, first of all, about Digital Exclusion Alliance and then the work of the Digital Citizen Unit within government. Bernie.
The Digital Inclusion Alliance was a commitment that was made in the full business case for Connecting Scotland that was approved in 2023. We understand the aim of the Alliance is really to bring about connections across sectors, so public sector, working in the private sector, internet service providers and so on, plus the third sector coming together to secure outcomes around addressing digital exclusion. From where we're sitting, we can see there's been a number of... It's still at a quite developmental stage. There's been a short life working group with COSLA working together with the government. There was a planned launch for March, but we've not seen what that has resulted in. I think we would expect that there would be a bit of clarity around, who are members of the Alliance, what's the remit of the Alliance, and what outcomes it's aiming to achieve. But we've not seen that as yet.
Right. And the Digital Citizen Division, what does that do, and why is it being so slow?
So that's a unit within the Digital Directorate within the Scottish Government that's got responsibility for Connecting Scotland programme, the Digital Inclusion Alliance, and developing various initiatives to address digital exclusion. I think we're not clear why things have been slow. Obviously, we recognise that there was, when Connecting Scotland was set up during the pandemic, it moved at quite a pace. There was a huge scale of activity, 1,000 organisations involved in its delivery, all councils and so on. But after that, there was a pause from around, early 2022, while the government looked at what its ambitions were around that programme. There was an outline business case approved in March 2022, and then the full business case wasn't approved until June 2023, so over a year later. Yeah. And the new programme was launched for Connecting Scotland, and the kind of post-pandemic programme, which is quite different from the original one, only at the end of 2023, and it's underway at the moment. We've certainly recognised that there's been a slow pace in progress, and as well the Digital Inclusion Alliance, but the underlying reasons, obviously, has been a changing financial context and so on, but I think that would be for the government to give more detail on that.
It would be for the government, certainly not for you to answer as to why they set up these bodies and then don't do anything about them. That's it from me.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm going to bring Colin Beattie in, but just before I do that, can I go back once again to Exhibit 2, which is looking at the potential human rights of people. And it talks about blue badge holders, people not being able to get access to a council tax reduction, people not being able to access the welfare benefit accounts, minority ethnic citizens because of language barriers not able to access services they are entitled to, and welfare sanctions for people who can't upload online their journal and so on. I mean, if you take the blue badge holders, for example, as I read what you've highlighted here, for people who are eligible for a blue badge, they have to apply online. It's online only. I mean, how does that sit with the stated aim of, I think, COSLA as well as the Scottish Government about the lenses of inclusion, offering signposted alternatives and so on? If it's exclusively online, that almost inevitably will exclude people who are entitled to that.
So I think just briefly, Convener, I think that's the reason why we highlight it in today's report, that it feels like there's a contradiction therein about the population who were likely needing to access this service and then the mechanisms with which they are required to do so by public services. The question we're asking, if you permit me, is are public bodies, our councils, might want to say more, are they content? Do they know that that arrangement is working for the people who need to access that service? And we're not clear that they do.
Yeah. OK. We are short of time, so I'm going to move on to Colin Beattie to put some questions to you. Colin.
Thank you, Mayor. General, I think this report's actually quite timely. It's been a long time since I've seen statistics on digital exclusion. In fact, the last time I had a figure for my own area of Midlothian was pre-COVID, and it was scary because Ofcom came in with a figure of 34% didn't have access to internet or smartphone. Now, clearly, COVID has moved that on, as we'll probably discuss later, which is very welcome for the benefit of those concerned. I'd like to just look at the audit focus group highlighted that people often have to rely on third parties, family members, for informal support to access the digital services. So things like paying bills online, utilities, all this sort of stuff are a concern. Can you maybe just expand a bit on the focus group's findings, and particularly around the impact that this can have on those people who need help?
Yeah, I'll certainly start and bring colleagues in. Mr. Beattie, that I think maybe just to highlight to start of section 2 of our report today, paragraph 27, that reliance upon other people to help them pay bills, to pay rent, requiring friends or neighbours to give meter readings, potentially the disclosure of personal financial or medical information to, albeit relative or friend, but it's that sense of it's not straightforward enough or easy enough for people to access digital services themselves. And I think we've touched on this morning and in the report some of the reasons why that's the case about digital skills or access to devices, but also the design of public services too. And I think for public bodies themselves to be absolutely clear that through well intention to develop the pace of digital technology and some of the financial imperatives around it that Mike referred to, is they're not inadvertently excluding yet more people. But we can clear in about some of that impact that we set in the report, but maybe just add a little bit more colour to that, if that's helpful. Gillian might want to say a bit more about some of the detail of the focus group's feedback that they shared with us.
Yeah, I think, as Audrey General says, we have touched on some of the things this morning, but the impact of digital exclusion can be quite severe for a lot of people. And as we say, it's often people that are already disadvantaged already. And then they're further excluded from accessing services that they need. Often it's people that need a lot of support from public services, but if they can't get that, then obviously that's going to have a big impact. And it's not necessarily just one thing or one service. It can be multiple things that people are trying to do. So it's that kind of overall effect it has. And we're finding that public bodies often aren't aware of it, or they don't consider that as they're moving online, so not thinking about people not being able to access and then what that impact has. So where we're seeing the good practice examples, that's what's happening. They're involving people from the beginning, thinking about what it is, consulting their communities to find out what the barriers are and trying to address those. But just in terms of some of the impact, as we say, it limits people's access to services, but wider life opportunities, and it can affect quality of life as well. It can affect people's social well-being if it increases social isolation and makes it difficult to access information. Economically, if it's difficult to apply for jobs and gain skills, and then that has an impact on financial well-being as well. And people just not being able to shop around or use online payments. People get into debt because they're not able to make payments if they have to go online. So, you know, it's, again, it's that cumulative effect. And I think, you know, the more problems people have or difficulties, you know, they get more frustrated, or they're less likely to engage with them, or they don't trust the services, they don't trust government, they don't trust the council, whatever, you know, whatever service it is, and then, you know, they're less likely to use it. So I think the more support and assistance that people can have if they are having difficulties accessing online services, then, you know, that's going to encourage people to use them and get better access as well, albeit that there should be, you know, alternative methods too.
Can I just ask about the statistics you're taking out, which give indications as to where there is exclusion? If someone is using family members and so on to access internet and to do some of the day-to-day stuff that is absolutely essential online, is that masked in these figures? In other words, how do you know that they're doing that, and what proportion are doing that? Is that 15%, 20% actually? How do you work that out?
Yeah, well, I mean, we don't work out the statistics. You're relying on statistics collected by other, you know, national organisations. But I think, yeah, I mean, that's possibly a case. You know, it could be underestimating because, you know, often people are relying. But, you know, some people don't have other people to rely on. So, but I think, you know, from talking to other national organisations like Age Scotland and Citizens Advice Scotland, you know, I think they get a lot of inquiries as well, and you know, that's the benefit of having these sort of community hubs or libraries having access as well. But it is the statistics aren't entirely reliable, you know. It's but it's the best we've got. I don't know if Bernie wants to
say
about the stats.
Because if you don't have anybody to support you, then it's easy to pick them up statistically anyway. But if they're getting support and assistance with their day-to-day access, mm-hmm. you could argue, well, that's okay, they're okay. But there's questions of confidentiality and all sorts of things involved in this, and the right that they have to be able to access. Mm-hmm. Is clearly there's no real way to pick that up, and any figure would be a guesstimate on that.
So I think there's an element of that. I think what we're content about, the sources that we refer to in the report, recognising that some of this is voluntary disclosure that people make. You know, there'll be surveys, there'll be samples, and then thereafter an extrapolation of the sample across the wider population. There is more detailed you know, geographical statistics around, you know, broadband rollout and the provision of high-speed internet. That is analysed both on council basis and on a constituency basis as well. So there are some details behind that. But I think we just agree with the point that you make, Mr. Beattie, is that there's enough people here. And, you know, in the statistics that are telling us about not having the skills or internet access in their homes to make this really important, and especially with the pace of change we've been speaking about and the further digitisation of how public services will be delivered, that this feels like, I'm grateful for your feedback, that this feels quite timely, just as a reminder for public services as they're going through a pace of change, is that they're designing public services with users, all users of their service, at the heart of that change.
Just looking at Exhibit 3, programmes at tackling digital exclusion, and I'm looking at Scotland's Digital Participation Charter. Now, the approach adopted by that is ethical and inclusive, which are fine words. What does it actually mean? And has there been any evaluation of the Charter's impact?
So the Digital Participation Charter has been around for some time, and just to provide an update, there was actually a relaunch a couple of weeks ago. There's a new Digital Inclusion Charter. So it's essentially a refresh of the Digital Participation Charter. That work's been led by SCVO and has been supported by the government. What underpins the charter is essential digital skills. So it's really about a means of trying to make sure that staff, volunteers, have essential digital skills, and that they can then support service users, citizens, etc., to develop them in that sense. I think that's where the ethical inclusive language comes in. It's in 2023 there were 700 signatories to the Digital Participation Charter, mostly in the voluntary sector, but also in the private sector and the public sector. And obviously with this new inclusion charter, it's really just about to, you know, a refreshing, trying to bring this to light again and get more organisations involved in this effort.
And what about some actual evaluation of the impact?
I'm not aware of any actual evaluation of the charter. There's obviously the charter, and there's a fund that's sat alongside the charter that's existed since 2014. So that's kind of small grant programme to mostly voluntary sector organisations to do digital skills work. So we've not seen a particular evaluation of that and what the impact has been.
Is there any intention that some sort of evaluation take place? Is that part of the programme?
I'd need to check with the government. We'd probably have to give an update on that. Yeah.
Is it worth maybe touching on the evaluation of Connecting Scotland? That if that's kind of part of your thinking, Mr. Beattie, Connecting Scotland was the entity set up during the pandemic, mentioned a couple of times this morning, to roll out emergency digital access during the course of the pandemic. And that reached, you know, £50 million spent for 61,000 households in the country. And there has been an evaluation of that activity. This, I suppose, it informed where we've got to today with where they are, they go into the next stage of their service delivery. So, you know, users, referenced in paragraph 33 of the report, noted an increase in digital skills, confidence. Younger people in our household were able to continue participating in online learning and schoolwork. And then it also supported access to employment opportunities. The only thing the other found with the project, you know, delivered by third sector partners, it's an expensive model. And a conclusion about the sustainability of that primarily one-to-one support wasn't something that could be continued with. So I think really where they go next in terms of that transition plan and evolving into the next phase of, you know, whilst supported by strategies and funding, I think as we've touched on already this morning to a degree about how is that then taken forward with the strategy to clear action plans and responsibilities, and that, for us, feels like one of the key gaps.
You move smoothly on to my next question there, which was connecting Scotland. And I think you've really answered that. The Joint National Digital Strategy, what's it achieved so far? And can you clarify what impact the lack of a clear plan and accountability has on tackling digital exclusion?
So for today's report, you know, whilst noting, you know, the presence of the Joint Digital Strategy, and might want to say a bit more about, you know, COSLA's role in that, is that it, and I don't wish to labour the point, Mr. Beattie, but it lacks a clear delivery plan with detailed actions about how ambitions, policy intent to tackle digital exclusion will be taken forward. The respective roles of the Scottish Government and its digital departments, and also that of the local government digital office. We were surprised, and Mike, I'm sure, want to say a bit more, that the local government digital office in its strategy ambitions doesn't make reference to digital exclusion, which, given the central role as it evolves, further provision of digital services within local authorities felt like an omission. And I say maybe Mike might want to say a bit more about that.
Yeah, OK. I think one of the central sort of choices for local government is, do you join up to a nationwide service? Do you do things once for Scottish local government, or do you do things individually? So, I mean, one of the purposes of the national strategy is clearly to help with that, that first question about what's going to be done nationally, some of the components that are being done by, led by the Scottish government. I think up until now, the Digital Office has been focused on trying to encourage, you know, once for local government in Scotland. And the latest programme that SOLAS and the Improvement Service are working on in terms of the Council of the Future has got two projects which relate to which services can be shared and done once and therefore well-designed and robust, and also what does the Digital Future Council look like. So I think there is a recognition there for digital services generally that the Digital Office has a really important role. When it comes to digital exclusion, any role at the moment appears to be implicit rather than explicit in that they have got they work with local government to promote the Scottish design standards and the other related frameworks which help accessibility. But where the gap appears to be is in relation to the range of issues of digital exclusion and the support that can be given. And I think it's fair to say that we were surprised that the Digital Office does not have something more explicit in that area. But it also has to be recognised that while some digital exclusion challenges are solved digitally, actually it's other areas which can be very, very important, and in particular building digital inclusion into anti-poverty policies and other policies to address to address the different vulnerable groups. And again, for local government, it may well be that's not the Digital Office, that may well be the Improvement Service or other players who support across local government.
Is there an assumption that everybody wants digital services? Is there an assumption that if these programmes reach out to everybody who is digitally excluded, that they will all be happy and cheerful and want to sign up? Or is it a fact that there's going to be always a core who, because of various reasons, maybe by choice, maybe by physical disabilities, old age, whatever, are never going to pick these services up, and they were always going to have that proportion which need extra assistance?
So we think it's absolutely that latter point, that public services have to offer a choice. You know, so whilst many, many of us will seamlessly transition from traditional service models and to embrace digital, you know, service provision alternatives, that doesn't work for everybody. So whether it's a choice that's made by individuals, or more worryingly, if the choice is made for them by public services about how service models are delivered, if that's the latter, then they have to back it up, you know, with connected work across the public service, you know, from government, local government, service providers, third sector, that people are equipped with the necessary skills, devices, access routes to continue to access in an equitable way how public services are delivered. And really that's the core of today's report from us, Mr. Beatty.
I'm conscious of time. I've got a couple of quick questions just to ask you. Back in March 21, our predecessor committee recommended in its key audit themes, Managing Public Sector ICT Projects Report, that the Scottish Government should appoint a senior individual to assume overall responsibility and oversight of all public sector ICT proposal projects. The Scottish Government responded to say it would consider this. you know, as part of its work to deliver the updated digital strategy. Are you aware if that recommendation was ever actioned?
I would need to follow that up and perhaps come back to the committee in writing. Perhaps as an interim, the committee many times has had representatives from the Scottish Government, from the Digital Director, the Director General for Corporate, who, you know, has overall responsibility for the delivery of those services. But you've also had a range of witnesses for major ICT projects. So I think probably rather than giving an answer on the spot, Mr. Beattie, I'll need to come back and check that. And indeed, I'm sure the government themselves would be able to provide that clarity.
Okay, fine. And my last question, which is probably more for Mike Nielsen. Do you know why the local government digital office doesn't include digital exclusion as part of its work programme? Is there any sign it might be amended?
In the latest updates, which I think is a month or so ago, again, there was no explicit reference to exclusion as such. But I think the point I was making earlier, that there is some work in relation to digital exclusion in terms of better quality design of services built into their core programme, as it were. And the issue is really for the other aspects of digital exclusion, which it looks like there's a sort of a gap for the collective of local government.
But they don't specifically have it as a...
Exactly.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. Thank you, Commissioner.
Okay, thank you. I've got a quick question before I bring in our final questioner from the committee. And that is, we read in the report about the government talking about a minimum digital living standard. Could you tell us a little bit more about what on earth that is?
Yes, we can, Kavira. Just to refer to Section 3 of the report. And the government has set out their ambition for a digital... minimum digital living standard, which, if it's helpful for the committee just to read that out, includes having accessible internet, adequate equipment, the skills, knowledge and support that people need. It's about being able to communicate, connect and engage with opportunities safely and with confidence. Build on the work from academics at the University of Liverpool and supported by many organisations across the country about really that overarching, how are services delivered, how will the world be delivered equitably and fairly. We do note in the report, though, that whilst the government has set out that it's this is part of their ambitions, they haven't yet mapped through as to how they will yet deliver upon that.
OK, thanks. That's helpful. I'm going to now move on, and the final question from the committee this morning is Fulton McGregor, who fittingly, given the topic of this morning's evidence, is joining us digitally by video link from North Lanarkshire. Fulton.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. And you've stolen my line there, convener, because I was going to comment on the fact that I'm digital for such a session. I've really enjoyed this morning's session so far. It's been very, very interesting. I wanted to ask a couple of questions. The first I wanted to ask is around about the report sets out the measures that Social Security Scotland has in place to minimise digital exclusion. And these include benefits can be applied for non-digitally, face-to-face guidance and home visits being available. Can I ask the panel if you know if these measures that have been put in place by Social Security Scotland have been shared with other public bodies? And if so, how are these being shared?
So I'll bring colleagues in a moment, Mr. McGregor, just to develop upon that. I think, as I mentioned, perhaps earlier today, is that we were keen to, this was a balanced report, that there are areas of good practice. I think it's really perhaps the core of your question about with a public body is doing well and is offering a range of channels with which to access their services, and that's working effectively, that they then share that with other public bodies. So just check in if we've got examples of the evaluation of that approach and whether that's been adopted elsewhere. Julie?
I think the point we're making in this section is that there are good things happening in parts of the Scottish Government, you know, in different directorates, but there's not enough happening around that learning. So while they're being developed within Social Security, within the Digital Health and Care Directorate as well, that there, I think, you know, there's probably some learning, but it's not been done on a sort of consistent and systematic way, and it's back to the, you know, that sort of feeding into the overall actions and leadership around this. I'll just check my Bernie if there's anything else.
Just to add, I think it is about that kind of collaboration and shared learning across the government that's been lacking. We mentioned in terms of governance structures, there's a an Exhibit 5, there's a digital board that is largely officer level at a Scottish Government level, but it's not met for quite some time. And when we look at the review of the digital strategy, whilst there's some update on Connecting Scotland, we're not really getting a flavour of those other things that are happening elsewhere in government, such as Social Security Scotland and the Digital Health and Care initiatives and so on. And that's, we have as one of our recommendations, that there is a community of learning established that allows that more collaborative learning to happen across government.
Okay, thanks very much for that. Moving on, there was a recent BBC News article reporting that £10 million funding for the Connecting Scotland programme was to be suspended during this financial year. Just wondering if you can comment on what impact you think this might have on tackling digital exclusion and the implementation of the recommendations that you have in the report.
So like you, Mr McGregor, I think we've seen some of the recent emergency spending controls that the government have put in place to deliver financial balance in this year. We've currently got work underway that we'll be bringing to the committee later this calendar year on public service reform and fiscal sustainability. But it perhaps echoes previous conclusions that we've reached in the past couple of years when there's been in-year spending controls, that government and their partners know what the impact is going to be, perhaps not for us as auditors to say what the impact will be, although I think there are clear strands in today's report about the impact that digital exclusion can have. But as spending controls and choices are made in year, that government is absolutely clear about what the impact that will have, perhaps not just in isolation in one financial year, but into future financial years. And is something that we'll be following up during the course of our current work and bring back to the committee later this year.
Yeah, thank you very much for that. And my final line of questioning is on digital services, council digital services. And I think the report highlights, and I think that we probably all find that with constituents, that sometimes council digital services aren't always easy to access. Your report does go on to look at some of the strategies that the particular councils are doing, sort of, again, almost good practice examples. And I guess that's as well as individual councils. There's probably good practice with different digital services, even within councils. So I'm wondering what further support you think is required from the Scottish Government and COSLA to ensure that some of the positive work that councils are doing to eliminate digital exclusion has been shared and applied at a more national level, so it's not almost a sort of postcode depending on what council you live in.
The starting point is, as Bernie's already mentioned, is this community of learning, because I think sometimes communities of learning can be, as it were, a substitute for action. But in this case, it's, I think, really central that where there is good practice, it's shared. I think the second big issue is that there is still a tendency to see, to design and think about individual services as opposed to the impact of the range of services that a particular individual really needs. And I think that's one of the places where the local challenge and the importance of effective collaboration, whether it be through between health and social care and local government, or in the broader sort of community planning context, to actually ensure that locally the services are being delivered in a way that is conscious of the risks of the digital exclusion poses. In terms of what more COSLA should be doing, I think that there is a need for support from the centre in terms of driving towards greater consistency of services and sharing shared services to simplify life for those who are sort of at the edge of digital exclusion. In terms of what Scottish Government should be doing, I think that I'll hand that one back.
I think the only thing I would add is there's a partnership between Scottish Government and COSLA in terms of the national strategy. I think, yes, there's a role for government in there, but also I think recognising, as Mike refers to, the local government service design group. So there are structures in place, Mr McGregor, about the drawing together good practice that you refer to, and we have case studies in today's report, Perth and Kinross, Renfrewshire Council, about where digital services are working well in an inclusive way. There is the infrastructure to use this. So the local government service design group has got 17 councils in place. So I think a question for the other 16 about whether that's the right setting for them or otherwise, and how they are sharing good practice from where it is working well in some councils and applying that knowledge carefully.
Thanks, Convener.
Thanks, Fulton. And we've got time for one final quick question, and I'm going to invite the Deputy Convener to put that to you. Jamie.
I'll be as quick as I can. So I'll do it in two halves if I can be very quick. The first one is, did any analysis take place around the MyGovScot portal, which seems to claim glowing success with 2.3 million users in Scotland and the sign-up of over 40 organisations? Not many of, certainly my constituents that I speak to, have ever heard of it or use it, but it seems to be a glowing success. But was that part of your analysis?
So I'll bring colleagues in to say a bit more about it, but I think perhaps, and again, people with me can say more about the MyGovScot portal, one of the reasons why it's the growth in numbers is that it's part of the arrangement for the national entitlement cards. So children and young people to access free bus travel, it can require an account on MyGov in order, therefore, to access the bus travel. But we haven't done any detailed analysis of its success or otherwise, unless colleagues want to tell me otherwise.
That's fine. I mean, it sounds like something that may have potential for growth or more inclusive services or access to more public services if it was part of a wider strategy, perhaps. It's, the infrastructure's already there. And the second half, sorry, the cheeky convener, was just back on the social tariff issue. I'm trying to get my head around this. 9% of around 5 or 8%, I wasn't sure which, of those who are eligible to take up a social tariff are taking up a social tariff. I had a quick look, and those tariffs range from about £12 to £25 per month, depending what sort of speeds you want, from 35 or 15 megabits per second up to about 150. So it's not bad, but it gives you basic access. Even at a basic level, do you think there's a place perhaps for government subsidy in this area? So, for example, 100,000 households connected at basic speeds at 12 quid a month would cost the government £14 million per year, but that would bring in 100,000 people straight into the digital sphere straight away. Is that the sort of intervention you think would be helpful, we should be probing government about?
I think these are the choices that government are facing currently, given, as we mentioned, and members of course will be familiar, the challenging fiscal context. There is going to be a prioritisation required. Some of that is happening at real pace, and with whether it's the Connecting Scotland programme or some of the other emergency controls, about that policymakers are absolutely clear what the opportunity cost of different choices that are made. So whether it's further intervention in social tariffs or subsidies, you suggest, Deputy Convener, the benefits of that are understood both in the current financial year and into the future. But clearly these are, you know, the policy choices for government and parliament.
If government's got no money, the major five providers of internet and mobile telephony in the UK made over £10 billion profit last year alone. Did you think there may be a role for the private sector to chip in and show its charitable arm in this respect?
So these are, in terms of the, you know, my role is about the role of government and the success of public spending. What is clear nonetheless, though, is that the success and the provision of internet, mobile telephony won't be a state-led operation. So, you know, the role of regulators in Ofcom are clear that social tariffs play a role in supporting digital inclusion and access to wider public services, but perhaps not for me to comment about the profits of mobile and broadband providers.
Thank you. Thanks.
Okay, on that cautious note, we will draw this morning's evidence to a close. Can I thank Mike Nielsen from the Accounts Commission, Bernie Milligan, Gillian Matthew from Audit Scotland, and of course the Auditor General for your time and the very useful evidence that you've given us this morning. We will consider what our next steps are going to be, but can I thank you very much indeed for your customary willingness to be as open and wide-ranging as our questions ask you to be. So at that, I will draw the public part of this morning's committee session to a close, and we will move into private session.